Good morning and welcome on the Sunrise Safari. As you can see, we're out before the sunrise this morning and the times are definitely changing. My name is Brent Smith. I'm going to be your guide for the next 3 hours. Unfortunately, we do only have one vehicle operational at the moment. I have Brian on camera, and together sometimes we're known as the killer bees. So hopefully our reputation will precede us and the animals will pop out in front of us. So welcome. We're sitting on the northern boundary. It is a lovely morning, only 18 degrees, 63 Fahrenheit. So not cold at all. Summer's definitely on its way. I'm in shorts and just a light jersey now. So none of these big jackets and gloves and beanies and things. I'm very, very happy for that. And there's this wonderful fresh smell around and there's green popping up everywhere, and we will definitely show you that. So 4 days after the rain, some of the grasses are coming up and some of the succulents are already out, and I'm hoping we can possibly find some wildflowers this morning as well. So if you are new, we are live. So you are pre-dawn or pre-sunrise here in the African bush with myself and Brian, and we have Tara and Nikki in final control. And we are out on an African safari. We're in search of all the big things, lions, leopards, elephants, as well as the tiny things, new budding flowers and birds and insects and frogs, one of my favorites. So we're gonna keep checking this northern boundary. I did hear lions during the night to the north, and I'm hoping they might have meandered south. If not, we'll be checking for all sorts of tracks and whatever else we might be able to find. One of the most incredible things is that not only are we live and you are joining us in real time for an African safari, is that you're able to ask us questions about what we see out in the bush. And there are two avenues you can do that by. You can email us on questions@wildearth.tv, or if you're a bit more tech savvy, you can use the Twitter sphere, and you can do that by just using the hashtag Safari Live in your tweets. It does feel like an age since I've seen lions, so hopefully we will find some lions. So my general plan for the morning is we are going to check the northern, the eastern and the southern boundaries, and these are sort of thoroughfare zones, and there's certain areas where we often find tracks of those cats coming across, and if we do, we're going to follow up and see if we can find them from there. If we don't get any luck here on Juma Private Game Reserve where we are at the moment, we're going to cross a little bit further to the west to Arethusa Private Game Reserve. And see what we can find there. So while we're chatting about big cats and are in search of big cats, Lindsay was wondering, which leopard did James see on the Sunrise Safari yesterday? And it is a leopard we don't see very often. And I know this is probably not going to make me the most popular, but for me, she's definitely the most beautiful out of the female leopards I've seen here up in the north. And her name is Kwatile. Kwatile, translated, means the angry one. So maybe when she was younger, why not, she had a bit of a reputation for being a bit growly and snarly. But one of the reasons I do very much like Kwatile is I actually have spent quite a bit of time with her, I wouldn't say ancestors just as such, but her four mothers, not four fathers. And she comes from a leopard lineage that comes from the central Sabi sands around the Sand River. That leopard lineage is started, or the first female recognized in that sort of family tree, is the Sunset Bend female. Now, for me, even when I was working down at Londolozi in Sindile, you have these very different lipid lineages, and you can actually see the sort of family traits passed on, not sort of individual spots and whatnot like that, but sort of a general look about them. So the Sunset Bend lineage is a very dark, almost jaguar-esque coloring, dark leopards, much longer faces, and then for me they are the most beautiful leopards that I've seen in this area, that whole Sunset Bend lineage. So as far as I know, her mother was the Campbell Corpy female, who is the daughter of Vumba, and the Vumba female was a leopard I used to see a lot of. And actually, where I used to live down in Londolozi, I had a nice big veranda in front of my room, and during the hot summer months I used to take my afternoon naps on the couch outside. And while I was having one of these afternoon naps, I just sort of had this premonition that something was watching me, and I woke up and there was the Vumba female about 6 meters away from me in the middle of the camp in the middle of the day, watching me have a nap. I didn't feel any danger or threat, she just sort of had a look and then she meandered on her way. So they've got sort of a much longer noses and that dark coloring I was talking about. And oh, look at that sun. But if we chat about the other leopards, well, the leopards we see regularly here, the two females, which are Karula and Shadow. There we go, the sun has popped up over the horizon. They're definitely much paler than Kwatile. Much shorter faces, and no less beautiful. I think beauty is in the eye of the beholder. And I think just because I've spent such a lot of time with that Sunset Bend lineage, a lot of my favorite leopards in the Sabi Sands were all daughters and granddaughters of that Sunset Bend female, and who I actually saw as well before. Well, she was quite old by that stage already, but there was another female, was a sister of, or half sister of, Vumba. Oh, sorry, of Kwatile, not Vumba. Vumba was the mother, called, had two different names. At Londolozi, we used to call her Shidulu, and that means termite mound, because we used to see her quite regularly around a road that was named after the huge amount of termite mounds on it, the Shidulu female. The guys in Maramala used to call her Kikalezi. So, now that is a half-sister or a sister of a Kwatile. And they're very, very beautiful leopards, and I said I spend a lot of time with them. And that sister of Kwatile, I was lucky enough to find her cubs for the first time in the Sand River, and also with Vumba. I've been lucky enough to Kwatile's mother, I've also found sets of her cubs for the first time. And I wonder, could one of them have been Kwatile's mother, the Campbell Corpy's female? That is such a long history of the leopards, from way in the south to up here in the north. So guys, unfortunately I've got to go through this little dip here, and it is traditionally a bad signal area, so I'm going to try and move through it as quickly as possible. I'm not going to talk till we're up and over and through the other side. Approaching the Buffalo's Hook waterhole now, and I can definitely see something. It is a predator, but probably not the predator you're thinking. We have an avian predator. Great predator of fish and frogs. A saddle-billed stork. Fishing the edge of the Buffalo's Hook waterhole. Oh, look at this. You can see there's a blacksmith lapwing bombing it, and here comes the second one. Now, there's a very important reason why they're doing that, is they have more than likely got a nest somewhere around. And though, even though a saddle-billed stork mainly eats fish and frogs and other aquatic things, if it came across baby blacksmith lapwing plovers, they would eat them or eat the eggs. So the adults, ooh, it saw something. The adults will definitely try to defend it. I mean, they will defend their nests against, oh, got something, a little fish by the looks of things. And very sorry, we seem to have gone for black screen as we approached the waterhole, but fortunately back now with a hunting saddle-billed stork. You can see how it pops its head from side to side, just in case it's chased anything in the opposite direction. You can see it might work its way through to that sort of little inlet there, where it might be able to corner something. These opportunities, or sightings like this, give us the opportunity to listen a little bit. So if the lions are roaring, or leopards are roaring, or if a prey species has spotted them, we might hear the alarm calls. Only one small fish so far. You can see that very much swayed side to side. So this rain we've had will, ooh, after something there, but it escaped, will change the saddle-billed stork's behavior a little bit. Those of you who watch the dam cams regularly will have seen them around the Juma Dam cam very, very regularly, taking advantage of that very, very shallow, muddy water that the catfish were stuck in. Unfortunately, towards the end, the catfish actually were too big for a saddle-billed stork to grab. But this rain will bring out a whole bunch of different species that they can feed off. I'm sure some of those very big dragonfly larvae and lots of frogs. I know for our regular viewers, this is quite an easy question for you, but I'm sure there could be some new people out there who are just as keen to learn. So why don't you guys let me know whether this is a male or female saddle-billed stork? feeding directly, almost directly towards us. Almost done the whole periphery of the waterhole while we've been here. So for those answers, whether it's a male or female, send your answers via email through to questions@wildearth.tv, or you can use the hashtag Safari Live on Twitter. So a little bit earlier, we saw those blacksmith lapwings bombing the saddlebald stork to protect a potential nest in the area. And Lisa was wondering, what do we call birds that nest on the ground? Well, Lisa, we call them terrestrial nesters. There are quite a few different species. Most of the lapwings are plovers, and the little plovers, like the three-banded plover, Franklin, guinea fowl, thick knees, will all nest on the ground. So terrestrial nesters. I'm going to spend a few more minutes here. That stork is heading back towards where the lapwings were, so he might get bombarded again. Oh, Brian spotted one of his favorite birds to film. Oh, pied kingfisher. Very well done to MJ, Nancy, and Joanne from Arizona, who all got that answer correct. It is a female saddle-billed stork. Now, let's have a look if those lapwings come around. So the reason it's a female saddle-billed stork, unfortunately my bird book doesn't have a picture of a male and female, it's only got one, but we've got such a beautiful view right in front of us that we might as well use the live animal rather than a picture. So we have a look, the female has a yellow eye when she turns her head, and also on the side of her face there is no yellow wattles. You can see the yellow saddle, but if we come down off the side of the face, there'd be two yellow wattles like a male. Or the male would have two yellow wattles on the side of its face. And you can see this, the stork's not going around to where it got bombed by the lapwings. It's decided it's better to just avoid that area. So, as we're about to leave the saddle-billed stork hunting in Buffalo's Hook Waterhole, we've got one last question on them from Jerry in California. Jerry, I hope you're having a wonderful sunny Californian day like we're having a wonderful sunny African day. Jerry would like to know, where do they migrate from? Well, Jerry, saddle-billed storks are resident. They do not migrate, so they will be here for the whole year. Kingfisher Brian? Oh, he's flying over. No, I landed in the tree. We'll keep a quick eye on the kingfisher as well. So, Jerry, they live here for the whole year. There will be little local migrations, not really migrations, but they will move from waterhole to waterhole. And the two we see, and often in pairs we'll see them, the two we see will be resident over all the waterholes in Juma, and they will actually defend those waterholes against other saddle-billed storks. In areas like the Okavango Delta in Botswana, where there's a lot more prime habitat for them, they don't move as much, Brian. There's a white-bellied sunbird in this combretum. You see him there? We're just going to wait. There's a very, very pretty little bird hopping around there. For those of you keeping a bird list, might be one you don't have. A little white-bellied sunbird. It's our most common species up here in the northern Sabi Sands. And you see that little brown one at the back? That's the female. So you can see this combretum is in flower when a lot of the others aren't yet. There's a couple of reasons this is. Yeah, obviously that little bit of rain has really helped, but mostly because it's next to a waterhole, so there will be, it would have taken moisture from the ground. And Brian's doing a fantastic job. Sunbirds are probably one of the hardest things to film because they are so busy and they fly so fast. And using that curved beak and elongated tongue to get the nectar out of those tiny flowers. There we go. See how he's using that curved beak. And is that the female? Is that a different sunbird species at the back? I think there's another sunbird species in the tree here. Looks like we might have a second sunbird species. Just gonna. Yes, Brian, go to the one at the back there.
No, go to
the... Oh, look at that. Isn't that stunning? We just wait for him to pop out into the open. Really beautiful bird. So that's great about having limited flowering trees at the moment. They're going to be little sunbird hotspots. Just going to wait for them so I can get a clear view before I move forward with an identification. Now, here's my bird book. There we go. Now, just turn around for us. Can see much darker, doesn't have that white belly. See the black belly. Did you see that little reddish band and a blue band on the belly? Now, some of the identifying features of some of the sunbirds, and some of the sunbirds can look very, very similar. And you got to start looking very carefully at those bands across their belly. Did he fly out? Okay, well, I'll find them in the book for you while you guys keep watching the white-bellied. And I'm quite sure this might be a new bird species for those of you keeping bird lists, that second sunbird we had there. And he was one of the double-collared sunbirds. Oh, or was he? I take that back. Not a double-collared sunbird.
We saw a very brief view.
Oh, what you found, a starling.
Yeah, Birchall starling disappearing. And
so, a very nice sunbird. One we don't see too often. I actually haven't seen too often in this part of the Sabi Sands.
Now, the reason we can tell it was a purple banded sunbird is because of the black belly. Oh no, sorry, not purple banded, I'm being America sunbird. You see the black belly, and it's got those double bands that almost look reddish but more purple. But the black belly, the other double colored sunbirds have a very light colored belly. So the other ones we might possibly get here. Those old forest sunbirds. Here we go. You see a very much lighter colored and much more red. And we didn't have that sort of scarlet. So, America sunbird. So what do you guys think? It's either number one or number four. So I'm going to put it to you. Now look how similar these two species are. I've given you two options. I've given you the purple banded and the Mariko. So it's a little bit of a test for you guys. And also a test to get me back into my sunbirds. I haven't been looking at them for too often. He's back, Brian. We're looking at number one and number four, but we'll get back to the book once we've got a bird right here, which is always better than a book. There we go. There you can see that purple on the chest, and as the sun comes out, that iridescent glow from the feathers. Oh, isn't he being so kind and out in the open? So guys, this is where birding can become very difficult because you have species that look so similar. So this isn't a Mariko sunbird. In fact, it is a purple banded, and that's just based on the size. The Mariko sunbird is a much bigger sunbird. It's one of the larger sunbirds. Oh, look at that, those colors. See, in body size, quite a similar size to the white-bellied. So those are some of the smaller. So when we're looking to ID something like a purple banded versus a Mariko sunbird, I mean, they are so similar in their color schemes that it is generally the size. And it has, the Mariko will have a much longer and thicker bill than the purple banded. And I can't see the female yet, but she could be around with him. Oh, look at that. The sun giving those incredibly brilliant emerald feathers. And we can see that purple band with a blue band above it. And here we go, the female, that's also another giveaway now, that it is a purple banded sunbird. Slightly yellowish belly. Isn't that stunning? And off they disappear. Into the thick. So we've just been chatting about that beak and that long curved beak. I'm just gonna jump quickly here. And they've got very specialized beaks and feeding. For feeding, whoopsie, taking things with me. We've got these incredibly delicate and beautiful flowers. I'm going to pop them on the dash so you can have a good look. And it's a russet bush willow that they've been feeding on. So if we have a quick look at this flower now, you can see how delicate it is and how small it is. So, I mean, they've got to get their tongues and into that tiny little thing that's holding the nectar there. So incredibly specialized. And Paul noted that they look very similar to hummingbirds. They are quite similar, except they're quite a lot more robust. They're actually quite a lot bigger birds than hummingbirds. We don't have any hummingbirds in Africa. It is a new world species, or to central and from southern North America down through Central America. But they do have very similar feeding styles, except the hummingbird will often be on the wing. It doesn't perch and feed like sunbirds. But they do have this incredible tongue that's able to go down that long beak and get at that nectar. And then a very big well done to Monica, who's got number 50 on her bird list. So very well done, Monica. So I think we've had such a little fantastic time here at Buffalo's Hook Waterhole. Saddlebill's still there, but unsuccessful so far. And we're gonna maneuver on and see what else we can find. Well done, Eddie, Ali, and Pretty Nightmare, who worked it out before I told you it was and it's sunbird. So we're just going to cross through this dip at the back of the waterhole. Unfortunately, we do have some signal issues. It is one of these blind spots. Oh, look at them just sitting there next to you, Brian. No, he's flown away. Now we can hear him making lots of noise as he disappears. It was that virtual starling. Go up and through. So a very big welcome to Jen from Canada, who's a new viewer. Always wonderful to have someone new on the back of our vehicle. Jen, an absolute pleasure to have you on safari. And Jen, being a new viewer, is wondering what cat species do we get in the reserve here. Jen, we're in the Greater Kruger National Park. We're in a little sort of corner in the center and or the central and western sections called the Sabi Sands. It's a private reserve that borders the Kruger National Park, but there's no fences and the animals are able to move to and from as they please. So it is about 7 million acres that these animals have to roam in, so there is quite a lot of movement between the animals. But back more specifically to your question, Jen, about what cat species do we get here, we obviously get the big hairies and scaries. So the biggest cat species we get is obviously the lion, and the next one along in there is the leopard, and we have cheetah, and then from there we move into the smaller cat species that we don't see that often but do occur here. I think the one we have seen a couple of times on the live drives, and Brian and I were fortunate enough to be the first people to catch it, as far as we know, alive on drive, was serval, which is an incredibly beautiful little cat. We also have caracal,
which is also known as a lynx. We've got the long tufts on the ears. And we have African wildcat. And those are the true felids or cat species. So your two bigger ones belong to the Panthera family, which is the big cats. And they have the ability to roar. And they have a very specialized hyoid bone in their throat that enables them to roar. Everything below that, including cheetah, are smaller, and their hyoid bone is solid, not elastic, and so they are not able to roar. And cheetahs being quite a strange one, they're their own little family, the Acionyx, and then all the rest belong to the genus Felis. And that is all the little cats. Now, speaking about little cats, I've got a very interesting question for you guys. And let's see, out there, I'm sure quite a lot of you out there have house cats. And do you know why the cartoon with Tweety Bird, I think it was, Brian, you might correct me if I'm wrong, that had Sylvester the cat? Yep. So who out there can tell me why Sylvester was named Sylvester the cat? Out of all the possible names they could have chosen for a cat, why was it called Sylvester? And you can send your answers through to questions@wildearth.tv, or you can use the hashtag SafariLive if you're on Twitter. Why was Sylvester the cat in the cartoon Tweety Bird, I think it was called, named Sylvester? Out of all the possible names they could have given that cartoon cat, why was he named Sylvester? We've been quite lucky with the sunbirds this morning. I mean, I don't think we've shown a sunbird for quite a while, and to have two species in one tree was incredible. And carrying on with those sunbirds, we have a question from a new viewer, and a very young new viewer. Welcome on the Sunrise Safari, Gabby, who's 7 years old and from Johannesburg, South Africa. Gabby was wondering about the color difference between the boy and the girl birds. And she was saying, are the boys always bright and pretty like that, and the females sort of gray and dull? Well, Gabby, in a lot of species that is the case. And with the sunbirds, it's very apparent that almost all the males have got all those big shiny colors, and the females don't look so pretty. So it's the opposite to humans, Gabby. So all the girls look shiny and pretty, and all the boys not so much. But so the reason for this is, Gabby, that all the boys want to look pretty, because they're all looking for a wife. So the prettiest sunbird with the brightest colors is going to attract the females. And the females don't need to go running around looking for males, because the males are always looking for them. So they don't have to be shiny and stand out. And so that's why the boy sunbirds are all bright and shiny, and the girl sunbirds don't have to worry about how they look. So guys, it seems like I made a whoopsie, and thanks very much for setting me straight. Quite a few of you, Gilly, Chris, and lots of others, said hummingbirds actually occur all the way from Alaska throughout all the states in North America. So I apologize, I only thought they were in the south. I've only ever seen them in the south. Where did I see them? And I have a friend who lives in Arizona who feeds them that sugary water system substance on their travels. So I do apologize for that. And then Carol was wondering, Do we have bee eaters here?
We do, Carol, and
some of the migrant bee eaters should be arriving quite soon. The two migrant bee eater species we get here are the carmine and the European. The resident bee eater species, the most resident bee eater species we get here is the little bee eater. But also, but normally closer to the bigger rivers is white-fronted bee eater. We might see them in the summer months moving away. Sorry, I saw another bird, not a big one. There he is. Disappearing, skulking through the grass. You've got him there, Brian. Quran. So yeah, Scotty's just calling me on the radio. Brian's going to just show you a particular red-crested Quran who's disappearing. Standing by. Govey, no problem. I'm on cheetah cut line heading south. So there we go, a little red-crested Quran, and hopefully we're going to be able to catch the mating display, which should be coming along shortly. I have heard them calling. I haven't seen any bombs from the sky yet. So as we were just saying, how the male birds have to impress females so much. Unfortunately, I couldn't see whether that was a male or female as it disappeared. But as with the sun, or not quite like the sunbirds rely on very pretty colouring. The Qurans are actually very similarly coloured. But so then the male, to impress the ladies, he'll fly up into the air, he'll do that call, and then he'll go straight up into the air and just close his wings and plummet to the ground, and just before he opens his wings, and that's to show the females how impressive he is. And one of the reasons that they have such a very sort of visible display is that so it can be seen by multiple females over a distance and hopefully attract in a mate. So well done to Pretty Nightmare, Robin, Raisa, and Nancy, and many more. I thought I might have foxed you there. So that is very correct. The name for Sylvester the cat from the Tweety Bird cartoons comes from a play on the scientific name for a wild cat species, which is Felis sylvestris. So very, very good, guys. I'm much smarter and faster than me this morning, it seems. So I think I'm going to have to up the game. So, back onto cartoons and cartoon cats. Why is Tom from... I'm joking. We all know it's Tom because it's a boy. Tom and from Tom and Jerry. So since we speak so much about Twitter and you guys all use it regularly, Paul said maybe Twitter was named after Tweety Bird. Possibly, Paul. I actually think there's a strong possibility. And ex-Ranga, I thought Sylvester might have been an African explorer. I'm not 100% sure. I think if I remember my cat history correctly, Sylvester is actually possibly a European wild cat, but I will double check that for you. Of cats, there are not many footprints on the road this morning, but we will continue on. Scott, Jamie and James and Steph are out checking the other side of the reserve for me, seeing if they find any tracks on tracking team. So always great, we have such a wonderful team that we're always out to help each other, and it's always much easier when you do have a nice tracking team who's got your back out there. So we've just been chatting quite a lot about the different color variations in some of the birds we see. And Bugsy and Barb are wondering, they thought it was possibly so the females were more inconspicuous while nesting. That is a possibility, but one must remember most of those nests are also built by the males, and the males in quite a lot of the species will help raise the chicks. So there is that bright flashing thing that will be around the nests. So there obviously is an element of that, but most of these vast sexual dimorphism, like we see in Nyala, is all for sexual competition and mating rights, mostly. Not always, but most of the time. Well, since we've started so well on the birds, and we can, I think let's keep going. Let's see how many bird species we can get on a single drive. I'm talking too much, and now I've cost us a bird species. It was a little emerald spotted wood dove. Hopefully we shall be able to find another one of those. But you guys are going to have to keep track for me. So let's see how many bird species we can get on this sunrise safari. And hopefully we might get some of the first migrants coming back as well. Just a quick one to add to the list, one we do see quite often, but let's put it in the bank, and it's a fork-tailed drongo. So Marion's saying she really likes marabou stalks, but we don't see them too often. I know James had some on a safari not so long ago when the Juma waterhole was very, very low, and they were there trying to feed off those catfish. I can hear a Cokie Franklin off to the left. And also on those larger birds, PK from Iowa is saying, well, where do they nest? Well, they form big flat stick nests normally in dead trees or larger trees like jackalberries, and they'll form a big flat crown of nests in this area. In areas like the Okavango Delta, they nest in things called heronries. I think that's... and heronries, you'll have multiple species of egrets, herons, and storks all nesting in zyzygiums, or water berries that grow in the water and generally on oxbow lagoons and that. So it just depends on the area, but they do nest in sort of big stick nests in trees. Of course, now this Cokie Franklin has decided to stop calling. I guess somewhere around that termite mound. Oh, one's called further away, he might respond. Or not. Okay, well, it doesn't seem to be playing the game, so we will carry on. We've just been chatting about bee eaters, so we've got a question from Chris, not about the feathered bee eaters, but the bees themselves. Chris would like to know, do we have Africanized bees here? Well, Chris, what is referred to as an African killer bee or Africanized bees in the United States and Europe is our stock standard honeybee. So we do, and they're from here, and we do see them quite a lot. And I haven't found a hive yet, but they move quite a lot during the dry season in search of water and pollen. But we will keep a lookout, and I'm quite sure we possibly will find a hive at some point. Another bird we see quite often, but let's just pop it on the list. There you go, long-tailed shrike or magpie shrike. How many are we on now, Ryan? What do you think? 10? 11?
At least.
At least. What do you think's a good... Brian and I are going to just try and make up... What is a good target to get to on this sunrise safari? I think we can get to 50 bird species. It's going to be a challenge, but I think we can do it.
Okay.
We got the killer bees. Brian with that smooth and quick camera work. I think we got a chance to get to 50 species in one drive. So, just as I mentioned, Brian's fantastic camera work, Lucy from South Bend, Indiana, has complimented Brian on his incredible filming of the birds. Well, Lucy, I agree with you completely. I'm very lucky to work with a cameraman like Brian.
Thanks, Lucy.
Oh, another one for the species list. We're gonna get a safety shot from a distance before we try closer. Here we go. Beautiful birds. And they have a long curved beak, very similarly shaped to a sunbird, but for very different reasons. They use that curved beak to pry under the wood, and that to remove beetles, and to go right into the wood to remove borer larvae. And that is a green wood hoopoe. Oh, and we hear that call. I'm going to try to go a little bit closer. They are sometimes quite difficult to get a bit close to, but definitely worth a try. See them. Wonderful red bill, the white windows on the long tail and wings. And as the sun catches them, they'll get that iridescent blue. They're looking for all sorts of chochos. For those of you not sure what a chocho is, it's a South African colloquialism for bugs. A chocho or a nunu. Okay, let's see what else we can find. So the wonderful thing about a bit of rain and now a bit of heat is that not only are the flowers and the grass going to come out, but some of the insects as well. Hang on. You can hear Koki Franklin again. So out of the Franklin species, your Cokie and your Shelleys are far more retiring. So they skulk through the grass, making them a little bit more difficult to find. I think maybe no. Okay, keep moving. So, as we continue on our avian-themed morning, I have a very impressive bird list. Laura from Finland said, thanks very much for the sunbirds, but also she is on 160 species since the drives have begun. That is incredible, Laura, and keep it up. Hopefully we can make it 161 today. Don't you spot, Brian? Still on the subject of birds, Ivy from New Jersey is wondering if we get any orioles here. We do. We get the eastern black-headed oriole. I actually had one calling right outside my room yesterday, so hopefully we are able to find one. But off the birds for a second, and we have a mammal for a change. Blue wildebeest bull. This is that old territorial bull we have seen quite a few times on in this area, and he'll be hoping now with a bit of rain and some green flush on the grass that the ladies are going to be coming to visit him. We'll even be on his morning graze. So we've got another spot to check. I'm not sure whether this nest's being used at the moment, but always worth having a look. Another one for the list for the morning. Chin spot batters. There you go. Turn around, let's see if you're a girl or a boy. Looks like a male chin spot batters. The female actually has the little red chin spot. And they've got a wonderful call. Three blind mice. There we go. Give the full call. No, he's only doing half. Can't entice him to finish off. There we go. Three blind mice. So the battises are little flycatchers. And off he goes. There's another one for the list today. Battis is one of the little flycatcher species. Very, very pretty. And definitely one of the calls we hear a lot out here. So next stop is hopefully going to bring us another species. And they are nesting there, or they have been nesting there in the past. This is the wildebeest walking up the road, the one we just seen. So we're approaching this nest now. Brian, do you know this nest? In this. I don't think they're here at the moment, but it's worth having a look. The hole. No one at home at the moment, unfortunately. But that is a brown-headed parrot nest in this dead marula. There's a, at the moment, disused brown-headed parrot's nest, but this a nest like this might be used by other birds that now that they've vacated. You could find this would be a really nice nest for a lilac-breasted roller, or even a hornbill, but a hornbill would close up the nest and with mud eventually if there was a female with eggs inside it. Also, the wood hoopoes could use this, those green wood hoopoes we just saw. So a lot of these holes might be used by various different birds at different times, as well as things like monitor lizards and snakes and bush babies and all sorts. So a cavity in a tree is high-end realty out here. Approaching the southern boundary now, and then we're gonna head west for a bit, maybe stop by the Twin Dams waterhole, see what's around there, and Treehouse waterhole, and then maybe meander on to Arethusa. We might get some nice aquatic birds at the Arethusa Dam to add to the list. So 50 is our goal for the Sunrise Safari. I'm hoping we can surpass that. Can you guys let me know on how many species we're on so far? And you can do that by emailing us on questions at wildearth.tv, or you can use the hashtag Safari Live on Twitter. I'm having a quick look at tracks around here. Do you see any of interest? Excuse me. It's time for some water. I think it's going to be an absolute stinker of a day. It's already quite warm. Not only are we on the prowl for the predators this morning, we're on the prowl for the birds as well. For those of you who are birders, we would be watching. Oh, there we go. It's disappearing. I'm sure Brian can catch him. Yes, there we go. White back vulture. We can actually see that white back as he disappears there. That white in the middle of the back. There's another one. Not the best vulture sighting, but definitely identifiable. Distinct white back as he took off. Nice camera, Brian. We've got a nice little herd of impala here to the left. Let's see if there are any oxpeckers. It might be a little bit early. All these ones are having a bit of a game here. Where's
female headbutting a female. This is last year's babies all playing, deciding to have a silly few minutes chasing each other around. Those little tails as they flick, flick, flick the flies away. Well, unfortunately, no oxpeckers yet, and you can see they haven't extended their coat, so it is a nice warm morning. And off they head to the south out of our area. The land is devoid of large cat tracks this morning, and I haven't heard a peep out of the tracking team either, so oh dear. These fresh smells, I mean, they're completely different from the winter where you just had that dust there. It's a very fresh, almost clean smell we're smelling at the moment. There we go, we're gonna land. Nope, but still, there we go. Grey go away bird. Another one of our regulars. And as I said, let's put them in the bank, check them off and keep going. We're on a twitching morning today. For those of you not sure, it doesn't mean I've got a funny twitch. It's a sort of a birding term for birders. They're often called twitches. Probably because they twitch when they see a new bird species, twitch with excitement, that is. So we're about to go through a little dip. We might experience a little bit of signal breakup, so please bear with us. Another one of our regular birds that we see quite often. Have a look at Twin Dams. To be having a little problem with my earpiece. Well, we're just gonna pull down here and see what we can see while I try to fix it. I hear a bird party up here. guys, just gonna sit here and listen for a second while I try fix something here quickly. Okay, it looks like we're back. Well, Anna Marie says she's calling this episode Birding with Brent, but I think it should be actually the triple B, Birding with Brent and Brian. BBB. Brian's found another a yellow billed hornbill, another one of our regulars, but well spotted by Brian there. We haven't got them on the list yet for this morning. And Penny Pine and John are wondering about venomous reptiles and does this weather bring them out? Well, it should bring the venomous or the reptiles out, not only the venomous ones. And also, John's wondering if we can find an African rock python, if we're really lucky. It is possible. And I would really, really be excited if we did. Strangely enough, speaking of reptiles, I had a reptile in my shower this morning, a little red-lipped herald snake. Not completely harmless. If he bites, he can give you a little headache, but not too serious. But so we just moved him out this morning after I finished showering. Guys, I'm just going to get a hold of Scotty quickly on the radio. Scott. Thanks. I'm at Treehouse. I will head towards that position. So, a quick update from the tracking team. They have managed to find some tracks of, it looks to be, Shadow and Madiba heading south into Arethusa. So, we're going to head towards that area. We're going to keep up with the birds, don't you worry, but hopefully we can add some kitty cats to the birds. There we go. An arrow marked babbler. There we go. I wonder where the rest of his flock are. Normally very loud and moving together. Oh, I can hear some more in the drainage line. Oh, there's another regular. probably get off the list so we can start focusing on some of the more finicky species. Soon to be two in the tree. We can hear them calling. There we go. Oh, male was trying to get lucky there, but Cape turtle doves almost mating. Unlucky, sir. Line. There's a little metal front in there, so we'll spot another one as we meander through. Get him there, Brian, through that gap. You see him?
Not anymore, no.
Okay, see the come out of it?
Let's figure out where we are.
Where that Franklin is? So down. Come down a bit. There. Oh, he's flown. Not to worry. Crested barbet, but it escaped us. So we are slowly making our way towards that area where there are tracks of Shadow and Madiba. Scott and the rest of the tracking team are in that area there now. So taking a little bit of pressure off us so we don't have to rush there. We can keep going at a nice dead speed and keep looking for whatever else we might be able to find. I'm there. I know there's a lot of different birds you guys would like to see. Lily B would really like to see a Verroes Eagle Owl. Me too. And maybe if we have no luck with Shadow and Madiba, we might go look in that drainage line where we hear them calling so regularly around the Juma Dam camp. And Miss Jin would like to know, what is the rarest bird I've seen on drives? Miss Jin, I'm assuming you mean since we're here on the live drives. Well, I'm not 100% sure. Probably yellow billed oxpecker is the rarest one we've seen on the drives. There's another Natal Franklin. Sorry guys, I'm just going to be on the radio for a second. Tax coming. Morning, Tax. What was that update? Okay, copy. I saw some of them from Gary Main.
I just listened. I couldn't hear anything in there. Copy, thanks.
So just checking in with the other guides, seeing what's out there. See what they might have spotted. The light's going to be quite difficult, but there's a pair of cardinal woodpeckers. Oh, there's three cardinal woodpeckers. Could it be two boys competing for the ladies again this morning? I think that's exactly what's going on. And you can see the boys opening their wings, making lots of flapping. Copy, thanks, Scott. So definitely males trying to impress the female who's trying to probably just get some breakfast. You can hear that loud noise. You can see that dancing there, opening the wings. The female right up on top, and the two males constantly following. The male closest to her is probably winning, because the other male is staying a little bit further away. And you just catch those brilliant glimpses of red from their caps. There we go, you see there's that dance going on again. Well, as soon as the other male comes in, he can't help it, he has to be there closest. And a fork-tailed drongo just overseeing proceedings. It is, oh, yeah, they're coming to fly. And they keep going. Well, anyway, there's another nice one and a really nice little bit of behavior. So you heard me just say copy, thanks on the radio there. Scott is still on the tracks and he's just letting me know which way they've gone so I don't start in the wrong area. So we're gonna go join Scotty and the rest of the tracking team, see if we can find Shadow and Madiba. So guys, please let me know how many bird species we're on, and you can do that by sending us an email, questions@wildearth.tv, or use the hashtag Safari Live on Twitter. Might do the display as well. Here we go. Very high in the sky. I'm hoping they do some more of that sort of mating displays we've been seeing this morning. And there's a lilac-breasted rollers. See if they give their... There we go. There we go. That's part of the display. And that's how they get their name. They roll their wings as they go down. Unfortunately, they've disappeared quite far. And landing in the tree. But we hopefully are going to catch a really nice clear roller roll at some point. But there we go. There was a lilac-breasted roller doing a little bit of that also mating display. So it seems like love is certainly in the air out here in the bush at the moment. A little bit of rain, a little bit of greenery, a few bugs around, and everyone is got mating on the mind.
Another very good spot by eagle-eyed Brian Joubert. And notice how I used the word eagle there. So very clever this morning I am. So a very nice bird, very distinct coloration. And I'm going to let you guys ID it for us. And which bird have we got here? And you can send your answers through to questions@wildearth.tv or use the hashtag Safari Live on Twitter. For those of you who might have joined in late, my name is Brent Leo Smith. I have Brian Joubert on camera with me today, and Tara and Nikki in final control. And you are on a live African safari, and we are busy looking at an eagle that I'm asking you to update. So not only are we live, you can ask me questions and I can ask you questions. And you can send the answers through to the email address and the hashtag Safari Live on Twitter. Sorry, I got Scott just give me an update here. Copy, Scotty, can you go again with that? Copy, thanks. And there's another bird. And sorry, I also forgot to mention that we are on an avian hunt. We are trying to get 50 bird species on the Sunrise Safari, hopefully surpassing. And there, according to Final Control's count, that is number 22, the crested barbet. And Scott and James, and I think it's Scott, James, and Jamie, and possibly even Steph, are all out on tracking team, and they are hot on the trail of Shadow and Madiba. And they've just let me know where the last tracks are. So we are slowly moving to that area and to give them a hand. But while we let them concentrate on tracking, because they can get off the vehicle and spend time on those tracks, we're just going to keep up with what we're doing, see if we can find anything else, and keep adding to our bird list. We keep the quizzes and the bird game going. Shamrock says, how annoyed did I get with my parents with the constant quizzing growing up, or did I just embrace it? Well, Shamrock, I embraced it. My brother did get annoyed with it though, and my mother, but my dad and I were definitely embraced it. And we used to play these games for very, very long periods of time. So when I was from about 10, 11 years old, or a little bit older, we lived in Botswana, but I went to school in South Africa. So a drive to school, or a drive home from school, was a two-day affair. And the general knowledge game, the tree game, the bird game, and that was all done while driving down the highway. What tree is that? What bird's that? And fortunately, a lot of that information seems to have been retained. I'm not sure how. But yes, I'm very thankful to my dad and to my mom, and for those quiz games and whatnot we did play on those incredibly long journeys. So to give you an idea, from school to home was 1,800 kilometers. we've got another hornbill species who's shooting across. It's an African grey hornbill. Disappear. Guys. So, the difference between the hornbill we saw earlier and the African grey, the most noticeable difference is the one has a bright yellow bill, and the other has a grey bill. Also, black and white, generally the coloration on the yellow bill, whereas the African grey, as its name suggests, is just generally quite grey. To Arcee and Raisa and Joanne, it was a pale morph Warburg's eagle. Yeah, you got him there. Little emerald spotted wood dove. If we go in there, he's walking up the branch. There's another one. And you can see those emerald spots glistening in the sun there. A very, very pretty bird. Often the tracks we find on the road are from them. Ooh, quick, 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 quick. We've got chagras chasing each other. Oh, I don't know if we can count that one. There's a bit of a suspect view, but that was a black-crowned chagra. We'll definitely try to find a better view of one. It looked like two male chagras chasing each other there. But we do have this wonderful little emerald-spotted wood dove. Giving himself a little preen in the tree. So guys, just on the radio with Scott. Copy, thanks Scott. I'm at the signboards now, I'll be there shortly. So it looks like Scotty and them have found, what have we got there? Ah, it's a little emerald spotted wood dove again. Different one. Scotty and them looks like they've found one or both of those leopards they couldn't quite hear, so we're gonna shoot a little bit quicker there. And we will continue with the birds, don't you worry, but you can bird while viewing leopards as well. It's a fantastic thing.
Thank you very much.
we're going a little bit faster. We're trying to get there to find.
You can actually see the tracks. I'm not going to show you now, but you can see the tracks of Madiba and Shadow walking down this road. And Scotty and the rest of the tracker team have been following them for about the last half an hour, and they've managed to find it. So we're going to shoot straight in there and have a look. I haven't seen Shadow for quite some time. I have seen young Madiba, but not Shadow. So it'd be nice to catch up with her, have a good look. And it's really good that she's actually back with young Madiba. We were worried for a while she was going to abandon him completely at a very young age, but she is still caring for him. Now being attacked by a roller. That squawking in here is a lilac-breasted roller, literally flying directly above us. He wasn't really attacking us, he just happened to be traveling in the same direction as us. And for such a beautiful bird, they do have an absolutely terrible voice. Okay, we should be getting quite close now. So what we're looking for, guys, is we're looking for a mud wallow on the western side of the road. So that's this side of the road. Scott says they had a drink there and then headed into the bush, and they're trying to establish the sighting now. Tracks. I can see their tracks there where they've drunk. Can you get that one there, Brian? Not the nicest mud water to drink at, guys.
Is it? Are we too close?
Let me try a look at the monitor.
You can just see it there in the mud.
Scott. Do you have my vehicle order?
I'm at the second mud wallow now.
Copy, I've got your tracks, leave the road.
I've got your vision. There we go, we've spotted Scott. And really good news, both Shadow and Madiba are there. Well done to the tracking team. I think we owe them. Maybe I should cook breakfast for them this morning. Nah. He is looking a little bit too impressed with himself. You can see him sort of strutting on the front of the tracker seat there. That's Scott and Jamie. Thanks, guys. What's that? Under the bush willow. Thanks very much. Well done, guys. Good work. Here we go. I just spot a leopard. Panting. Hey guys, I'm just gonna have to be on the radio for a little bit, letting the Arethusa vehicles know where they are.
Is any station in the west copying me? And there's Shadow, he's a little bit grumpy. I'm not sure whether it's towards Madeira or us. Could be either. That's at Madeira, not at us. So there we go. He's getting a little bit of a snarling at by his mother. Any station in the west copying me? We've got Shadow and Madeira off airstrip link. Probably 200 meters to the east of the airstrip itself. Okay, copy. Sorry, I got short end of the stick there. Copy, thanks guys. No, we'll move out and move back once you guys are done. It's not a train smash at all. So as soon as the third vehicle's on approach, we'll go onto the airstrip and we'll come back a little bit later. Okay, copy, thanks very much. Sorry about that, guys. So unfortunately, Madeira is hiding behind a bush just to the right. We will try to get him in shot now. So he's moved a little bit away from his mother, just to the right of screen. Behind that little phlegia bush, white berry bush, that's where he's. There we go, just pick up his face through the bush there. So, when we initially arrived, we weren't sure where the Shadow was snarling at us. And she's still snarling away. And that young Madeira moves a little bit, she gets a little bit grumpy. It is possible that there could be a kill nearby. I can't see any offhand at the moment. But they definitely look very well fed. You can see heavy panting. It is quite warm already this morning. Brian and I are just having a quick squiz under all the bushes. Have a quick look at young Madeira. You can see he's also fat and full and panting away. They've definitely eaten well in the last while. I'm not sure whether there's actually a kill around here or they've moved from another kill and they've come to rest here, which is also a possibility. So
As I was talking about a few minutes ago, you noticed that heavy panting, and definitely very full. So they've definitely eaten something, and something quite large, because both of them are quite full. And that heavy panting is them digesting. And the digestive process in cats takes quite a lot of heat, or creates quite a lot of heat. And so what they do, that heavy panting is, they're bringing air over their tongue and their mouth, where they've got a lot of blood vessels and capillaries, and that air will cool down the warm blood and send it back through the rest of the body. So unlike us and horses and animals like that, they are unable to sweat. So their panting and lying in cool areas is their only form of thermoregulation. Morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Ah, sorry, for this. My Fufunyan radio is this.
No problem.
So when we arrived, Shadow was snarling and growling quite a lot at young Madiba, and a few of you are worried about that. Don't be concerned, she's probably full and she's hot and she's trying to digest whatever meat she has consumed, and he was probably just being a little bit annoying before we arrived, possibly trying to want to play with her, and she's just not in the mood. I wouldn't worry about that aggression towards him at all. You can see there's just mischief in that face. So they're nice and full. I don't think they're going to do too much, guys. And it is quite nice to see them together. So what we are going to do is, there are some other vehicles who would like to come and have a look at these guys, and we've had a nice little sighting here, and I don't think there's going to be too much activity. So what we'll do is we'll wait for the next vehicle to arrive, and then we're going to continue on and see if we can get to our 50 birds for the morning. And we'll come back here definitely before the end of drive, and there's our Madiba chasing flies. And he probably did the same to his mom's tail, which is what ended up with the grumpiness that we saw in the beginning. Well, who was the other station you're interested in?
This is Sept, and then I'm not sure if there's another one called in behind Sept. Do you know?
I think Sept said there was one. I'll ask him now.
Like that.
So guys, I'm just gonna have a quick chat with Cedric. We'll find out who the next person is wanting to come in here. So there we go. They say there is some meat here, possibly in those logs behind Shadow.
Okay.
Exactly. cheating.
We can't see what that meat is there, but Brian's managed to find it on the camera and zoomed right in on it. I have a look with my binos now, but Brian's a bit higher than me, so he can see into that section of logs. Unfortunately, I can't from where I am, but so I can just make out a rib cage, possibly something small, a young impala, or maybe even a dike. You can see the nyama there. Who's the next vehicle coming in? Just a little update from Scott and Jamie. Harley and his tracker, who's sitting next to us, are actually the real people who found these two leopards, so a big thank you to them. Walking and working hard this morning. Tight belly full of what we're not sure, but a very full belly. So for anyone who's just joined us and might have just woken up a little bit late or just got back from work, we are on a live African safari and we are sitting with a female leopard and her sub-adult male, and they have a kill under a log nearby and they are happy, fat and full cats at the moment. And if you want to ask any questions about these leopards, you can do that by emailing us on questions@wildearth.tv, or you can use the hashtag SafariLive on Twitter. So since we are with Shadow and Young Madiba, Barbara from Saskatchewan would like to know, because Shadow was seen mating with two different males recently, if she is pregnant, how much longer will she look after this young male? Well, Barbara, that is a question no one can answer for sure, because as much as we learn and read in the books, the leopards don't have to, and it is possible that she might even give birth and he might still hang around. It's unlikely, but possible. It has been documented before. But he'd probably have another 3 or so months left with her before she probably tries to chase him away completely. But as I said, this could be an exception to the rule, and you might hang around after she's been given birth. This has been recorded a couple of times, but it is very uncommon behavior. There's also a possibility that she didn't get pregnant from that bout of mating she did with Anderson in Tingana, so he could have a lot longer. So we will find out in a few months. Chris coming? Chris, just let me know when you do that and I'll make space for you. It's fine, I'm four. You can make your way. I'll come back later. So guys, we're going to give Chris a chance to come in here. We'll be back here. We'll go see if we can add some more bird species to our list of the Arethusa Dam.
So isn't that exciting? We've managed to catch up with Shano and young Madiba. We're definitely going to come back to them a little bit later. But wow, we let the other guys also get a chance to view them. We're going to continue on our bird challenge and see if we can add a few more birds to our list. We will definitely come back to those leopards, but on the topic of leopards, Diane from Pretoria, so a local South African from Gauteng, says thank you to Scott and Jamie, and I think Bernard, who is the tracker there, and myself, for managing to show her a leopard on her birthday. It's her favorite animal. What a great start to her birthday. Well, Diane, I hope you thoroughly enjoyed it, and stay tuned because we will be back with them a little later. Yeah. Back on the road, and I'm hoping we can add a few short grass species while we're around the Arethusa airstrip, and not including the caterpillars that are probably the largest caterpillars we're going to find in the Sabi Sands. Apart from the birds, we've had quite a few little discussions about cats this morning, and Siberia, one of our zoomies from the dam cams, is wondering, do we get African wildcat in this area? We do. Unfortunately, one of the biggest threats facing African wildcats is the domestic cat, and the reason for this is that they are very capable. I'm just trying to find out how I'm going to cross the airstrip at the moment. They are capable of breeding with African wildcats, and obviously that affects the wildcat's genetics. I'm trying to see, I think it's going to be this way. So we'll see, there's some guys here, they're busy tarring the Arethusa airstrip. Whoa, and there's a large warthog family, and they don't seem to mind about all the hustle and bustle on the Arethusa airstrip. So quite incredible. You're going to be able to take a commercial flight from Johannesburg to Nelspruit, and then from Nelspruit straight to Arethusa in the future. So that is why the airstrip is being upgraded, to make it easier to come on safari to these wonderful places. And no, not the prettiest birding, but birding nonetheless. And we have a crowned lapwing on the recently laid first layer of tarmac. And he seems still quite happy. And in front we have these two female warthog we've been watching for the last few months, who have done an absolutely sterling job with raising this many babies. I don't even see, it doesn't even look like they've lost. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Oh, they have lost a few. There were 9 in total, but there's 7 left. So only 2 babies have been lost. And that's incredible motherhood in this part of the world where there's such a high predator density. Almost like a herd of warthog rather than a small sounder. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven. 7 babies, so only 2 lost since we first saw them. And there's one of the mothers, Brian's on now. I'm Guys, be careful. There's a leopard probably 150 meters from here. You're lucky they're full though. And there's some of those babies. They are very sweet little. Yeah. It's got a nice flowing mane there. And there are people working on the airstrip, walking up and down it, and there's big machinery, and they don't seem to mind at all. Very, very relaxed little family group of warthog. Let's continue on. So what we're going to do is we're going to do a quick loop down to the Arethusa waterhole and see if we can add a few more bird species, and we'll head our way and spend the last few minutes or 10 or 15 minutes of drive with Shadow and Madiba. We'll just get all the other guys a chance to go view them and then we'll be back. But I think we're on about, we must be close on 30. So it is going to be quite a push to get to 50 in the last little bit, but we can definitely give it a good go. Quick, Brian, now we're going to do Ferrari birding. And another common one we haven't added yet. There's a red-billed hornbill. As we move down the Arethusa airstrip, in the past we have seen separatory birds here, and that's what Anna Marie is hoping for. Unfortunately, Anna Marie, I think with the current construction going on, it's not very likely, but fingers crossed, you never know. There's some more impala. They also don't seem to mind the construction. No oxpeckers on them, Brian. Yep. And there we have a large, slightly dismembered caterpillar who is a bit ill and is gone off. The engine seems to have left it and gone for repair. Hey guys, we're just gonna have to pop past here. Morning, morning, morning. Enjoy.
Johnny.
We'll see you there a bit later.
Ciao, ciao.
Sorry guys, morning meeting. Very friendly and brief one. And as we keep moving here, and we pass some impala here as we head down towards the waterhole. Crystal from California was wondering if those impala got separated, or kudu or nyala or any animal such, would they be able to join a herd that's out of their natal herd?
They would in certain circumstances, and I think with impala herds and that, there is quite a lot of movement between them, and I think they mix and match and intermash and move out. And with all the non-territorial species like kudu and inyala, I don't foresee it being too much of a problem joining a non-natal herd. And even with wildebeest. So yes, it would be possible, Crystal, for them to join the non-natal herd. It's got a bit warmer, the birding's got a bit trickier. So that's why we're going to head down towards the waterhole and towards the drainage lines where it's a bit cooler. As you can see, I've already lost my jersey, and it is, I think, going to be a serious scorcher of a day. Oh, gonna land. No, flying over at high speed. Was a pair of lesser blue-eared glossy starlings. Oh, we got another nice species to add to the list. One you all know very well. And the squirrels aren't happy with him being around. Basilea. And we can hear a white-bellied sunbird calling that beautiful little chirr. So there we go, a Basilea eagle. Let's go see what's around the water's edge. There we go. Some glossy starlings on top of a dead tree there. Oh! We start on the glossies before they fly off. Looks like Cape glossy, that one there. And if you go across to the left there, Brian. And there we go. Zoom in there. There's a little bushbuck doe as well, or bushbuck ewe, sorry, not a doe, a doe and a deer, a ram and a ewe. What a peaceful little scene, guinea fowls and bushbuck feeding under that African ebony or jackalberry tree. Probably on about 32, 33 species. What do you think, Brian?
At least.
So guys, remind me on how many bird species we are, and you can do that by emailing us questions@wildearth.tv or use the hashtag SafariLive on Twitter while we search desperately for another 20 species. So we're approaching the Arethusa waterhole now. Hoping to add a few aquatic species of birds to our list. Things like jacanas, maybe three-banded plover, grey heron. But who knows what it will hold. Thank you. Well, before we do the aquatics, let's go have a... There's a bird of prey in the distance. We're going to try and get a bit closer.